Greetings, Earthlings. This is a response to Clint, DaMadModler, who asked what was in our backyards. Well, this is my hometown of Rugby. It's known for its public school and for the game of rugby football that originated there. It was mentioned in the Doomsday Book of 1088 as consisting of a duck pond, three geese, and a goat called Arnold. And as you can see, progress since then has been on the slow side. This memorial commemorates Sir Frank Whittle, the inventor of the jet engine. He was born in Coventry, which is about 15 miles from here, but he did a lot of his pioneering engineering work on the jet engines at the British Thompson Houston factory here in Rugby. Holography was also invented in Rugby, again at the British Thompson Houston factory, by a Hungarian by the name of Dennis Gabor. Now, there doesn't seem to be a memorial to him, sadly. But it's jet engines and aircraft that we're going to be more interested in today, because we're going from here up the road about 15 miles up the A45 to Coventry, the outskirts of Coventry, to the Midlands Air Museum. Well, here we are at the Midlands Air Museum, and as you can see from here, the local IPMS chapter is also based here, the Coventry and Warwickshire chapter. But that's not what we're interested in today. This is what we're interested in. This is the Avro Vulcan, that I think is probably the centrepiece of the collection here at Coventry. And stuck right out here at the front is this, which I believe is a Bloodhound missile, which apparently has been placed here to deter people from parking in the disabled spots. It's doing a good job today from the look of it. The museum entrance has loads of model aircraft built by, presumably by the IPMS, hanging from the ceiling. There's a Catalina just for you, Clint. There's also a reasonably well-stocked model shop. It's mostly aircraft, of course, but there are a few armour kits tucked away down here at the bottom. There are quite a few books. I don't know why the Star Trek one's there, but still. And there are some magazine back issues, and more models, and more books, and a very small cafe. Some of those books that Cohen likes so much, and a bunch of paints and glue. But anyway, let's go in. I did pay, by the way, I promise. So the entrance to the museum proper is dedicated to local boy Frank Whittle, and it has his life story and several jet engines on display. So this here is the man himself. And this is the house in Coventry where he was born. Into the museum's main area now. There are more jet engines. And more jet engines. And a display case containing models made by the Coventry and Warwickshire IPMS members. This is the nose section of a Canberra bomber. And this is a Gloucester Meteor. This is the type of aircraft that my own father worked on while he was in the RAF. Now this is a prototype Leopard private jet. And this is a Swedish Tunnan jet fighter. The yellow aircraft up here is a home-built Turbulent. And here the replica of a Harrier cockpit. And over here a T-33 jet trainer. There's also a Vampire jet and various gliders and replica biplanes. And tucked away on any spare surface, radar equipment and ejection seats. T-33 is a two-seat trainer, and here it seems to have been configured for instrument training, because you can see there's a shroud over the rear cockpit, presumably to prevent the student pilot from seeing outside. This is the cockpit from a Glosser Meteor. Now I don't think the 1970s seat cushions are original, and it's not the last time we'll see them either. Now like most British aircraft of the period, it gives an impression of having been sort of cobbled together out of bits of old baked bean tins held together with chewing gum. It's not quite as sophisticated as US aircraft of the same era. There's lots of bits of bent tin in this, whereas the US aircrafts actually seem to have some kind of notion of fit and finish. This is the mock-up of the Harrier cockpit. And you can see the engine vectoring lever there below the black and yellow handle. This is a de Havilland Vampire with its distinctive twin booms. Now, one of our local pubs actually used to have one of these aircraft parked in the car park as a kind of gate guardian. Either that or the pilot was a regular. And this isn't really an aircraft, it's a Link flight trainer from the 1960s. So note the printed circuit boards there. This is another Link trainer. This is a rather earlier one and comes from just after the Second World War. My own father actually remembered using trainers like this when he was in the RAF just after the war. And there is a section dedicated to local aviation history. I'm not sure how they ever got that off the ground. This is the cockpit section from a Bristol Beaufighter. Now, Coventry was extensively bombed during the Blitz, and this exhibit has pieces of German aircraft that were shot down over the city, as well as accounts from people who lived through the bombings. The city actually was largely destroyed during the Blitz, and then destroyed again by the planners in the 1960s, who built enormous concrete lumps. Now there's also the wreckage of a Whitley bomber. concluding this tail section. This here is where the rear turret would have been. As you can see, not in great shape. This is the nose section from the Canberra bomber once again. It's possible to take a quick look inside. It actually seems relatively roomy, really. There's the pilot, and the navigator would have sat back there. The outside area also has a complete Canberra bomber, as well as quite a number of other aircraft and helicopters. That's a Sea Harrier. And beyond it is a two-seat variant of the Gloucester Meteor. That's a Hawker Hunter. And that is a Sea Vixen. This is a Fairey Gannet. And a Lockheed Starfighter. Now, the Sea Vixen is a very strange looking aircraft. It has an offset cockpit and twin tail booms. That's the Hawker Hunter again. Now, this is an Argosy freighter and a Bofors gun tucked under it. And this is a Gloucester Javelin. This is the Javelin once again. And this is the Seahawk, a small one-seat naval fighter. So MiG-21, this one appears to be in East German colours. And this is the front half here of a Blackburn Buccaneer. And this is the Hind E attack helicopter. And an F-86 Sabre. This F-4 Phantom is on loan from the US Air Force. This particular aircraft served in Vietnam, and it's a MiG killer. That is why it has that red star painted on the intake splitter plates. This is an F-101 Voodoo. And this is an F-100, nicknamed the Thud. Over here is an old DHC Beaver. And nestled here under it is this Dodge 1.5-ton truck with trailer. The museum has two English Electric Lightnings. This one is in RAF colours. While this one is in the colours of the Royal Saudi Air Force. For our Canadian friends, here's another T-33 in our CAF colours. This is a Bofors anti-aircraft gun. This is a ground tractor. I don't think the Wallace and Gromit stickers are original fit. And this is a Bolton Paul P-111, a prototype jet fighter from the 1960s. Now the Argosy is open to the public, so in we go. So that's the rear bulkhead of the fuselage. And here is where those 1970s seat cushions came from. Lovely. Now sadly it's not possible to get into the Argos's cockpit. This very small aircraft is a Fallon Gnat. Now before they switched to using Hawk trainers, the Red Arrows used this type of aircraft, and I understand that Dave Gilmour of Pink Floyd also owns one. The Vulcan is open to the public, but unfortunately there was no guide available to show me around on the day I was there. This is the Vulcan's front wheel bay. Just look at the size of these castings that make up the undercarriage leg here. And this is a blue steel standoff nuclear missile that was designed to be used with the Vulcan.